Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the SEMA Future Tech Live Stage. This is the second panel or conversation session we're going to be doing today on electrification. So if you're interested in electrification, make your way on over here. We're going to have a pretty exciting conversation with some people that I've gotten to know over the last couple of days. I'm pretty excited about this. We've got Rob Ward, CEO and founder of Legacy EV. He'll be up here having a fireside chat with Apple Diap of the Black Eyed Peas, founder of Green Thumb Garage, and Audi Vergara, director of Green Thumb EV. And they're going to be talking about the great F100 that they've got up here, as well as some initiatives that they're excited about with training the youth and the next generation of hot rodders that are interested in automotive through the lens of electrification. It's going to be an exciting conversation. You won't want to miss it. Let's start making your way over here and grab a seat. And with that, I want to welcome to the stage Rob Ward, CEO and founder of Legacy EV. Thanks, Rob. Yeah, go ahead and all hand. Yeah, there you go. You got a mic. And we'll welcome Audi as well, Vergara.
Thank you.
And Apple Diap. Thank you, guys. I'm here just to introduce the sessions. I'm going to step off stage. But thank you to Rob, Apple, and Audi for all being here to be a part of this conversation. And with that, I'm going to pass the proverbial mic over to my business partner and great friend, Rob Ward.
Check, check. Oh, it's on. Normally, it takes a minute. I got to tap it a few times. Hey, good afternoon, everybody. Day one. This is, I hope everybody's having a good day so far. I know for us, it's been pretty crazy busy. But yeah, I'm excited to be here. I think Apple and Audi are excited to be here. We got to hang out last night, get to know each other a little bit more. But today, our goal here is just to talk a little bit about the EV industry, Apple's foundation. And for those of you that might not know Apple, I want to start just by saying, like, can we talk music? I know we're at SEMA. I know, you know, we're here to for the automotive industry, but I'm a drummer, and so as a musician, I'm like totally awestruck and just like I'm on stage with Apple Diap from the Black Eyed Peas right now. So hey, thanks for coming.
Hey, what's up, Rob? Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for having us here today. And very excited to be here. I've been in this world a long time ago when I started music. And, you know, I had to choose between making a living or flipping cars. So I had to make music first. And, you know, became a Black Eyed Pea. And now that, you know, we have some times in our hands, continuing the passion and following an old dream that's been here all along. And now I'm just, you know, reattaching myself and hopefully to bring music along with it, you know?
Oh, yeah. I mean, all my fun cars have big stereos in them.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they kind of go hand in hand, right? But yeah, like, I mean, we were talking and you were kind of telling me how you got into music. I mean, you know, you 14 years old.
Yeah. So I was born in Philippines. I was adopted at age 14, brought to America. And my dad was best friend with Will.i.am's uncle. So before I was enrolled in school, they suggested Will.i.am's mom to babysit me until I was enrolled in school. So they take me to East LA, and I meet this young cat, same age, and she made him stay home from school to hang out with this kid from the Philippines, and he was not happy about it. He had a new girlfriend. I was like, what? I gotta hang out with this kid from the Philippines? Does he speak English? I mean, I've never heard of that place. And then so it took me to East LA, and it was a culture shock coming from the Philippines to America. And I remember before leaving Philippines, I asked my mom, Mom, how am I going to converse with people in America, you know? She's like, oh, Anak, you know, just read the dictionary and you'll get it in a month. And, you know, really get into your English subject. And so, you know, it was a So I got to East LA, and I sat on the couch, you know, timid, really quiet. I was like, don't talk to me in English, I might run out, you know? And then so Will finally started talking to me, and he's like, yo, you from the Philippines? I've never heard of that place. What do you do there? I'm like, yo, you know, I go farming, I go to school, and I like to break dance, you know? He's like, what? You know how to break dance? So he's like, show me some moves. So I just seen the Running Man on the Pepsi commercial, a Michael Jackson Pepsi commercial, a Next Generation, and I seen somebody just running in place. And I'm like, oh my God, how do you do that move? So when Will asked me to bust some moves, so I had to rock the Running Man. It's like, you know, I had to do the
yeah.
And then it's like, what? How do you know how to do the Running Man, you know, coming from the Philippines? I'm like, oh, I saw it on the Pepsi commercial, and I practice. And then the rest is history, you know. We form a dance crew, a tribal nation, where when I started meeting other Filipinos when I went to school, they started inviting us to, like, house parties. And that's where Black Eyed Peas got started. We started performing at Filipino house parties, joining the battle contest, the dance contest. And that's how we were exposed with the car scene, too.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
Growing up in an Asian community, everyone has, like, you know, dope-ass cars, drops, Civics, CRX. Mm-hmm. And, you know, trying to make it in a music business. We're like, yo, one day I'm going to have one of those. I'm going to drop that, put the body kit on it, you know what I'm saying? I have a pretty Filipina next to me with a long black hair, you know? Just dreaming as kids. And I attended all the illegal races from Sylmar to the Valley to West Covina. And we even got a telemarketing job during the summer in high school to get a car. And, you know, we got signed before we got to, we got fired. We actually got fired after like 2 weeks at the telemarketing. I still remember my tagline. Good evening. My name is Alan Pineda from the California Police Activities League. Can I ask you a few questions if you think there's other alternatives to keep kids away from drugs? And they're like, we're having dinner. and then, you know, then you just call a million people till you get to till you meet your quota. And then my best friend, Will.i.am, he started calling his girlfriend from a 714, and we're a 213 area code, and they start seeing the phone bills, and they found out that wasn't like a business call. He was calling his girlfriend, and we got hired together. We got fired together. So I got fired by guilty association, and
hey, I got another question for you. So obviously, Black Eyed Peas fan. You guys are a big deal. You've played some massive shows. Just for everybody here, what's your favorite venue that you guys have ever played?
Favorite venue? I think the most memorable show that the Black Eyed Peas has done is the Super Bowl.
Oh, you took my set into my next question.
Super Bowl. We were coming down from the scoreboards. We were there for like 30 minutes before even the show starts because, you know, we got to be ahead of time before even the game starts and the ceremony. So we were there with them skinny cables hanging on. And, you know, we've done, as a kid coming from the Philippines, being adopted, and then becoming a household name in America, it was like pinch yourself moment. I'm like, I can't, like, really, this is happening, you know? Mm-hmm. Like farming from the Philippines, being signed up to a foundation called Parallels Buck, where they support abandoned and Mauritian kids. And now I'm like hanging from a a cable to start the Super Bowl. It was like, what a moment, you know. And another memorable moment was, I remember after a month of being adopted, living in the U.S., before that, you know, we went to Disneyland, Universal Studio. I got to see, like, Knight Rider, the kid, got to talk to him and bragged about it back home in the Philippines. And then, you know, finally the adoption paper were finalized. And now I'm in America for real now, you know? And I started to get homesick. And I remember asking my dad, Dad, can you send me back home now? I miss my family, you know? Well, he's like, well, son, you know, I brought you to America to get an education. And you're old enough, you remember your family. Focus on your education and you'll see him again, you know? And so I would, you know, imagine 14 years old away from your family. I would cry, you know, every night. And then I remember Will, you know, trying to console me and like, yo, don't worry about it, Ab. We're going to make it and we're going to go back to Philippines and perform in front of your family.
That is so cool.
And so a decade later, we were able to go back to Philippines, perform in front of the president, my family, the army, and that's when the second memorable, you know, show that we've done.
Yeah.
Another one in Brazil, Ipanema Beach, countdown, it was over 1 million people,
oh, wow,
by the water in the beach. And
was that countdown New Year's Eve? Countdown?
Yeah.
Okay.
Countdown New Year's Eve. And yeah.
That'd be cool. Well, I want to start to dig into talking about your foundation and some of that. But before I do, I just got one more Black Eyed Peas item. And this is me personally here. My family loves being out on the lake surfing. I've got three kids. All my kids surf. And my middle child, her name's Brinley, and her nickname is Brinnerby. And she's born in 2010, and your song, I'm a Bee, became her special song, and we just changed the lyrics. So I would sing it to her, Brinner Bee, Brinner Bee, Brinner, Brinner, Brinner Bee, Brinner Bee, Brinner Bee, Brinner, Brinner, Brinner Bee, beep, beep, beep. I got it. No. So anyhow.
That's dope. That's a dope remix.
Yeah, she's, and the fact that we're on stage and we're talking about this, like, would just blow her mind. She loves you guys. But man, music, love it. But I want to move on to talk about your guys' foundation. And Audie, I don't know if you want to kick us off a little bit there, but let's talk a little bit about what you guys have done, what you're currently doing, and where we're headed.
Yeah, for sure. Hey, everybody. My name's Audie. Thank you so much for having us over here today. I got to tell you, I'm a little bit beside myself because when I first started coming to SEMA, it was maybe about 22 years ago. And when we were here, when I was coming back a long time ago, we happened to be around a lot of our friends who were doing import cars, a lot of like the Hondas and stuff like that. And what was amazing back then is that it was emerging at the time. And for us, car culture, we're from Southern California. Our foundation is founded in Southern California. We've always been around car culture. And the car culture that we're around is what you see in a lot of the movies today. And it's really fun to be here with you guys because we would never think that we would be here with our own car talking about EVs. And our foundation is really, really excited. You guys must be wondering, like, what is a foundation even interested in this space? It actually has a lot to do with the people that we grew up around. And we know that there's interest in the communities that we belong to. And we want to bring as much opportunity to these folks. And we're encouraging them to join the EV revolution and take a big part in what's going on. So that's really why we're here today.
Awesome. Well, yeah, I was excited to get the phone call from you guys and find ourselves on a Zoom call. And I think the first time we were on a Zoom call just talking about like how we could collaborate and do some stuff together, just so happened that Dan was like 15, he was Zooming from a hotel room like 15 minutes from our shop. And it was like, dude, we're in Tempe. You're in Mesa right now. Let's, you know. And so I feel like at Legacy, we're excited to be working with you guys. And yeah, I think that The thing that I feel like we're always talking about is just the need for EV education, and specifically how vocational programs are a great pathway, both here in the United States and in the Philippines and other places. So,
yeah, I mean, we've done a couple of scholarship programs in the Philippines, and not everybody's like, you know, want to go to a four-year college. Some kids' interests are into vocational, so this would be a great, like, you know, skills to teach, especially those vocational strong type of kids in the Philippines and as well as here.
Yeah,
I'd be the first to tell you that when we first started the year, we had always intended to go into EV education. Our foundation for many years has been involved in education, particularly overseas. So in fact, this is our first program here in the United States. The F-100 that you see over there with the mint green on it, in July, I'd be the first to tell you that we didn't think that that car would even be here. It just so happened that our friend's hot rod blew up. And we had always been looking for a car to convert into an EV as the inspiration for why we're even interested in this space. And lo and behold, it became that car over there. And that engine actually came from Legacy. And we're really excited about it because it's not one of those things where we're online looking for what might work. We actually were able, through our builder, to contact these guys. And we're able to get the support that we need, answers met. And for some reason, going into EV space seems more accessible than it ever was in the gas space, because I could tell you, I would never be here in the past. All of my friends who really know how to wrench would be wondering why I'm even here. A lot of it has to do with education and accessibility because of these guys.
Awesome. No, thank you guys for that. I think, you know, we're passionate at Legacy about educating the current automotive workforce. I mean, there's over 660,000 automotive technicians out there today, that there is a continuing education demand for them to get workforce development training so they can continue to do what they're doing as an auto mechanic and also be cross-trained in EV technologies. And then in addition to that, the future automotive technicians that they're currently in high school or maybe even younger. And so as a company, we offer, you know, high school elective courses. We have curriculums in junior colleges, tech schools, and then we do in-person certified technician programs. And I think that's where we could geek out for days, just talking about how far we can go with that program and, you know, spreading it across the world.
You know, for us, we're not in, we don't own a school. We don't directly teach folks. What we do is we provide scholarships and grants for folks to go find this and be part of this education. What's really exciting about right now is just 3 years ago, this didn't exist, but now it does. And with the US is investing billions and billions of dollars into infrastructure. If you see all these EVs over here, EVs might not be selling in the lots off of the factories, but there's a huge community of hot rodders that are discovering what EVs can become and the power it can provide. And these cars here are gonna help support the new infrastructure that's being built in America. And we need the technicians out there to help make it all happen. And that's what our commitment is today.
Awesome. Well, yeah, I think the last thing that I had notes here wise to go over is just, let's talk about the future. Let's talk about, you know, what we can do. I mean, we were hanging out last night and I think I officially committed to coming to the Philippines with you guys. I mean,
yes,
correct
you did.
Me if I'm wrong, but.
Yes, you did. You know, here for us, the future is very much, there are a lot of cars. We have an amazing infrastructure in America, and we want to make sure that we produce really great educated folks to help build the future. But even in Asia, we're talking to these guys about, you know, motorcycles and bikes, because over there, there's a whole lot of that. I think altogether, globally, we will hit a critical mass for all of these things. These things are not going away. Over the past just 3 years, seeing the growth, it's multiplied. I think it's really exciting what could happen next, but a lot of it's rooted in the education, and it starts today.
Yeah, and one of the things that we're running into, especially flipping a tricycle, is the drivers. They like to keep the aesthetic, how it looks, You know, yeah. when you start changing the shape, they're like, oh, what is this thing? But, you know, that type of procedure that we did with the F100, that's something that we could always replicate and flip all the jeepneys and tricycles in Philippines, you know, and still keep the look and the culture. And it's not so strange for people. So that's kind of exciting.
I just want to add on that. And this was a comment our friend who owned that vehicle said to us, the parts, the $130,000 that he originally spent on that, a lot of it wasn't for waste. By putting in that Revolt engine, he was able to maintain all of the parts that he had and some of the old tuning too. So he was able to take that car. We're able to take that car into the future in a new way. That's exciting for us.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I got a couple more items. Maybe I don't think this comes as a surprise, but you know, we talk about your automotive passion, and I think that, I mean, you shared some stuff with me that we haven't talked about yet, and if you're comfortable talking about it, I think, I mean, there's no doubt you have a passion for serving and giving back, and that's something that's near and dear to my heart. And your story about driving to your girlfriend's house in County,
yeah,
Texas.
So I love cars. I love driving. I've gone through the length of sneaking out my cousin's tricycles and jeepneys. And what I would do is I won't start it by the house. I'll push it like a block away and then kick top pedal, you know, so I won't get caught. But as much as I love driving, I'm actually diagnosed legally blind. I have a rare condition called nystagmus, which is the involuntary movement of your eyeballs. So it's kind of hard to focus, especially, you know, far away things. And, you know, I still try to push the limit on how far I could, go with my disability, you know. So, our advance from Roofless Records when we first got signed, we got a $10,000 deal, and there's three of us, so that's $3,333.39 or something. And with my $3,000, I bought a drum machine for music, a Volkswagen Beetle, and some clothing. And you know what how I would drive that Beetle around is I would memorize every stop sign, traffic light around my neighborhood, and that's how I was able to roam around, right? And then I had a girlfriend that lives like 30 miles away from me. And before I was driving, you know, she would take me to her house and I would memorize every exit, every block, every street. And then when I got my Volkswagen, I would just count all the exits and that's how I would get to her house. Okay, that's a third exit, fourth exit. Don't mess up now. Fifth, sixth, seven, eight. All right, exit right there. All right, make a left. That's that traffic light right there. I can't reach street signs, so memorization. So that's how I would get to her house. And then one day, I miscounted one of the exits. And it took me 4 hours to get home. I was just like, that's that mountain over there. I think that's Hollywood. Go towards that way. And then I would see a cop. I'd pull over. I'm like, oh, I reached my destination. And then they leave, and I drive again so I don't look crazy, swerving all over the place. And yeah, man, and that's how I would get to my girlfriend's house. And one day, I got lost in downtown LA. And in downtown LA, there's like one ways, and I couldn't see none of that. I didn't memorize downtown, so I went on a one-way street, and A few seconds later, I realized I'm in the wrong way, so I had to try to back up where I was, and then the cop was behind me. And then asked for my license. I didn't have one. Impounded my car, and that was the end of my driving career. Like, all right, I learned my lesson. Not supposed to drive. Let me just make cars now, you know?
Well, I just want to tell you, I when I found that out, when I heard that, I was shocked. I mean, watching you run around stage as, you know, a famous musician, and knowing that, like, you got to measure the state, like, to make sure you're not going too far.
I would go ahead of the show. I'll memorize the stage. All right, these are the toasters right here. Because there's a lot of lights going on during the show. So I did it all by memorization. And I do somersaults because, you know, me and my in the floor are best friends. You know, I could see that. I'm good with, like, backflips and gymnastics and stuff. So, yeah, I pretended a lot.
For me, it says a lot about you as a person. You're obviously high energy, hardworking, but you're passionate, and your desire to give back, take care of people, it's infectious. And
I want to be able to do what you guys do, what you're about to do over there, to change that car into EV in 4 days. I want to see that in Philippines.
I love it. And maybe that's a good, I mean, we've talked about scholarships. Maybe I'll let you take that, and we'll call that the grand finale and close with that.
Yeah, so our organization's teaming up with Legacy, and we're going to be working together to send a group of three folks, our first cohort, to get educated. And we're going to be converting some really cool stuff along the way. But this is just the beginning of what we feel is going to be a long-term relationship, which we hope become global relationship. And we'll see what happens next. But we really appreciate that you've made time for us, so thank you, Rob, very much.
Absolutely, and just to kind of expand on it, you know, we do a certified technician program training at our facility, where 20 students come and they get hands-on experience. They're in lectures with curriculum specialists, true, you know, master's degree holding teachers, who put them through a 1-week intensive course to understand the fundamentals of EVs. And working together with the Apple Foundation, they've agreed to 3 scholarships to send people to our training. We haven't firmed up the dates on when they'll be there, but we do it right now, 2 weeks a month. So there's a lot of seats. It's pretty full December, January, but into February, March, I'm sure we're going to make it happen.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you for an awesome chat today, man. We really appreciate being here.
Yeah. No, thank you guys.
Thank you guys for being here today.